Welcome to part three. We are going to machine the muzzle brake right now. First up, I've got this piece of 7/8 4140 in the Emco V13 lathe. I feel like it's been a while since we've seen this guy on YouTube. We are just gonna face it off. We're going to spot it with a number 5 spot drill. Then we're gonna drill it with a letter U. And I've just marked the spot on the drill, which is just past our 2.25 inch length. That way we make sure we get the hole all the way through. We'll follow it up with a 374 reamer. I think you could probably run it a lot closer to the 9 millimeter diameter of the bullet, but 374 is the closest size I have reamer on hand. So I think that'll be okay. We're not, this isn't a suppressor with noise, but rather a muzzle brake. And yes, you do want to strip off the gas, but hopefully it should work fine. Be curious to see if any of you gunsmiths or muzzle brake experts have any comments on that. As you saw there, my 374 reamer didn't do squat, so I grabbed my 376 one thou over, and it did cut some chips, but let's talk about being a smart machinist and being a dumb machinist. I was just a dumb machinist. I'm so excited to make this part that I didn't think a letter U drill is 368, 7 thou under. Drills walk, they don't drill round holes, and when you're drilling, 7 or 8 times the diameter of the drill in terms of the drill depth length, it's gonna walk on you. I should have left more meat on the bone. Luckily for this part, it doesn't really matter, to be honest with you, but that's still sloppy. I did grab a gauge pin though, and 377 gauge pin gives us a beautiful pop. So again, we're talking about being, 3 thou over what I wanted. So it's not the physical machining is not going to be a problem. It's more of the approach and being dumb, like I just said. Anyway, so let's hop over to the Tormach. Okay, parts in the 3-jaw chuck on the 4th axis. We'll come over to here to the far X side, use our Heimer. And there's 0. So in Mach, we'll enter that as 2.25. So we know that's the far right edge. Next, I find my Y, which I do by coming to the back side, halfway down, find 0, like so, and then hit 0 in Mach 3 on the Y, come all the way to the other side, go down to the same height as you did on the other side. It actually doesn't really matter. The closer to the center line, the more accurate. It'll probably be because of the greater differential, but it's more important that you're just the same Z height. Find the 0 on the Heimer, and then in Mach, just hit divide by 2. That puts you right in the center of the part, regardless of the actual diameter of the material. And then finally, so now we'll come to Y0, and we'll set our Z0. By going to 0 on the Heimer. And then here, the 0 is actually the center line of the stock. So here we are 7/16 because it's 7/8 stock, so we're halfway above it, so 0.4375. I always check to make sure your tool and tool holder are going to clear the jaw, and we were too close with this number 30 quarter inch end mill as we machined the flats right up here. But it's a trade-off because I could move the stock out further. But I don't want to do that because I'm not using the tailstock. I did just get it, but I'm not using that because we want a machine out here in the ends. So I extended the tool further out in the tool holder. I really don't like doing that, but it's an okay trade-off. So let's rock and roll, folks. This is a quarter inch four flute carbide end mill, 2700 revolutions per minute, 7 inches a minute. I thought we'd show one rotation at normal speed, which you're about to see right here. And then, here in a few seconds, we will do our usual fast forward to keep this nice and snappy. We're using a 2LN 30 degree engraver 5100 RPM 3 inches a minute, about 13 valve depth. It ended up being too deep, and I wasn't happy with how this turned out. So we'll fix it later, and I'll do a little video on that. Lakeshore Carbide 4-Flute 3/16 Carbide Coated End Mill. The whistling is from the, there we go, plugged it up. Whistling was from the hole in the my coolant system's air pressure. Thought that was kind of funny. Sounds like the one of those train toys. Anyways, 3,500 inches a minute, 3,500 RPMs, 5.3 inches a minute. When we switch to the 2-flute, we're just going to slow it down by half. It seems like it's a great cut recipe. Wanted to keep the camera angles a little bit fresh. I'm still getting used to filming with the enclosure on. The lighting is great, but you lose some of your angles and you've got more stuff to work around. But I thought this one showed off the fourth axis pretty well as we're fast forwarding here pretty quick to bang through this part here on video. I have posted 252 videos and I have never once not used the tripod because the tripod is a good idea. Nevertheless, I thought I'd try to handheld the camera here behind between the fourth axis and the column to try to get a better angle. And, you know, it does give us a better angle, but bear with me here as we walk through some of this footage. It's a little bit unstable. Oh my gosh. Guys, this is amazing. Holy smokes. Here's the thing. I don't have the dimple cam down yet. We're gonna just do that later. That'll actually be a fun separate video. I wanna get this thing out, cleaned up, and thread milled and put it to use. So I'm gonna disengage the stepper and just take a look, man. Other than some burnt edges to clean up, which we're gonna try hitting in the sandblaster, folks, amazing. I am super excited. I think this thing looks beautiful. Wow. Wow, okay, let's get out of here and play around. Again, one quick look before we clean it up with the sandblaster, and then I think I'm gonna hit it with a Scotch-Brite wheel too, or Scotch-Brite on the lathe. Folks, pretty badass if I do say so myself. Whew. Hit it with the sandblaster and then put it on a Scotch-Brite wheel. If you're interested in Scotch-Brite wheels, you can see video here I did on using them, and there's a link below to buy one. They're expensive, but they're amazing. It cleaned up real nice. A couple of lessons already learned. I hit the Scotch-Brite wheel a little bit too hard on the logo and basically removed the engraving. I'm actually okay with that because I wasn't happy with the engraving to begin with. My fault. I went too deep when I tried to correct it from 5 thou. I didn't mention this, but to 13 thou. So I've actually got a better idea, which is we're going to re-engrave it after we paint it. It'll look really good. It should pop. The other lesson learned is, and this is what the kind of stuff that bites me because I'm self-taught, is this is, I think, just cold roll, but it has a scale to it. I should have turned the OD of this. There's small amounts of pitting on the material. Not a big deal. In fact, when I paint it, it'll probably go away, but probably would have been better to do. But folks, oh my gosh, Does this not look amazing? Is this not a phenomenal little piece here? The cut quality was incredible. I mean, you guys saw it. The proof is in the pudding. I'm tempted to tell you how awesome the Tormach is, but I think you just saw it. Pretty flippin' awesome. So let's cut this off in the bandsaw and get this thing thread milled so we can get it on a gun. Let's thread mill this guy. So it actually isn't gonna thread on to the end of the barrel. I normally have this adapter permanently mounted to the gun because this is the thread pitch I use because I own a different suppressor that happens to be threaded, this 573 by 28. And so that's what we're going at here. And I have a thread cap here. So the way to measure it was pretty easy. Measure that ID there and I get 561. And that tells me the area, the diameter I need to machine out to. And then we'll use a thread mill to mill the rest. So I'll put over to Sprut Cam. This is the test piece. I'm way too much of a wimp to machine this without testing it first. And so I drilled it first, which we don't have to do because we have our drilled hole. Then we interpolate a clearance hole, and that ties into the 561, which you can see is, so you can use the Sprut 9, Sprut Cam 9. So there's the, oh yeah, there's the diameter of 561. And then we thread mill it, and I had a problem, which is that the thread mill wasn't cutting deep enough into the threads. And I've done some thread milling again in my other video where you could adjust the radial depth. For reasons I don't yet understand, that doesn't work in Sprut 9 for me. So what I had to do was just gradually increase this diameter right here. And again, you're gonna laugh, I usually cheat, and what I'll do is I'll line up the red toolpaths here, and when you adjust this and regen, you'll see if the toolpath itself has actually increased or decreased as you need to. A real quick review, we are using, let's see, 5100 and 8 inches a minute, and then the settings you need to go through, longhand thread milling, you need to do ID bottom up clockwise. This is 1 divided by 28, that's our thread pitch. And then the only other thing I do is this axial divide 1, which means it only really goes around one or a little more than one turn because we're using a multi-flute thread mill. So that's all we need. I'm not even going to use the solid model of the compensator because this is all, again, we need to make this happen. So let's head over to the Tormach and finish this up. Okay, folks, sorry, my battery died. You didn't miss much. We just faced off the top and found our X and Y zero using the outside of the 5C collet holder. And we are now drilling it. I know I said I wasn't going to have to drill it, but ends up that it was just easier to drill it before we use a quarter inch end mill to interpolate that hole and then thread mill. We just saw the part twist. To be honest, I wish I had said something because I thought that might happen. I don't always clamp these things crazy down in the 5C collets, and putting a twist drill through like that puts a lot of torque on a part like that. So it'll be fine. It won't move again when we're milling a machine right here, but something to definitely be aware of and, you know, sort of an amateur hour move. You also need to re-zero because no doubt that part may have easily pulled out a little bit. If you have a feeling of anticipation right now. You feel the same way I do. Let's see if this fits. Oh boy. Oh yeah. Look at that. Holy cow. We're not even all the way down. No wiggle to that. Free threading though. Nothing at all. Awesome. Bottoms out. Now, might be one problem. I look through the hole. You won't be able to see it until I take it out of the part. We might have machined too deep and screwed something up. I don't know. Can't imagine what it is just yet. We're going to take a look here right now. So we did screw up a little. I wouldn't call it a complete waste, but I don't like it, and I will probably make a new one and fix it because we just barely touched through right there. But actually, may not affect the performance all that much, but darn it, that wasn't what I wanted to do. You can see what I'm talking about right down in there. Still, folks, this is pretty awesome. We're going to see how it works. Let's go, we'll paint it later and engrave it later and do the dimples later. I'm going to do that in another video. Let's go throw this on the gun and see how she shoots. Holy cow, folks. So to be perfectly honest, I planned on taking some test shots with it, warming up a little bit. I haven't shot in a few days, and then filming the footage. But I thought if something goes wrong, I want to have it on footage so I can kind of see what happened. So those were no joke, the first few strings I took. It was one of the most proudest moments of my life. Again, you told me I could have made one of these things, I would have thought I'd be pulling my teeth out. It would be so difficult, let alone design one in CAD, let alone do it in really not that much amount of time and be so proud of it. This thing looks incredible, and we're not done yet. We're going to dimple it. We're going to re-engrave it. Can't decide, either powder coat or I bought some Cerakote, which I've never used before, so I'm thinking about Cerakoting it. Anyways, I'm on cloud nine right now. This thing is awesome, and honest to God, the muzzle, I don't know if we're going to be able to see it in the video, but the muzzle climb was materially better. Incredible. Same ammo, by the way, all that stuff. So that is a wrap, folks. Thank you. This has been one of my favorite series. I know everyone was excited for it. This is awesome. So happy Thanksgiving. I think this video is going to get released on Friday. So yesterday was Thanksgiving, but thanks, folks. I'll see you soon. Take care. Oh, please comment, thumbs up, likes, shares, all that good stuff. You know I love it. Take care. See you soon.